I think in my own head, I'm free to do anything that a man could do if I put my mind to it. I think we still have some problems, I think, in this society, certain discriminations.
Yeah, I mean, there are things you're not free to do. Like, you have to think twice before you walk around at 12 o'clock at night. And
I know the whole thing with the woman reporter in the locker room and the whole, you know, the sexual harassment that she experienced is a problem. I think a lot of times men see a woman as either being maternal or being sexy or being intelligent or being powerful, bitchy, and I think sometimes they have, this is vast generalization, yeah. But I think sometimes they tend to put women into categories and have trouble realizing that women can be a lot of different things at once.
Well, I think women are expected to be more supportive and nurturant of other people, and if women are not that way, if they're demanding in a professional context, they're seen as bitchy.
Maybe explicitly women are allowed to do whatever they can do, but there are a lot of barriers against women in a lot of places in people's minds.
Do you think women still tend to get stereotyped?
Oh, definitely.
In what ways?
I think that there are certain expectations that a woman is either expected to meet, you know, higher expectations before she's accepted as competent in certain areas.
And there were guys out there that had that, you know, I got to be the macho, tough, the aggressor, and all that other stuff. And they feel that women should be stereotyped as a little timid person who just basically eventually goes around to what the man wants. Yeah. It's too arrogant to see what a woman really wants and only what they think she wants.
Yeah. I think sometimes I'm seeing, because of child abuse that I've dealt with in the past, and this is where I get it from, is I don't know why the judges seem to be believing if a woman says her child has been raped, he doesn't want to believe her, or if the husband has done it, and this, I'm just really going out here, but this is what I believe in, that even when doctors come forward and say this child, you know, has been abused, they still will say, well, we're not going to stop the visitation rights. It's like they don't believe her. It's not enough. And the child is put back in that environment or whatever. The father's given visitation rights. You see it on TV. We've seen it. And you say, how come? So in that respect, I think, why? Because he's a man? He can't lie or deceive? That's not true. So I think things like that, things that are really important, is where we're still not getting into. The everyday living we've changed, not the real gut things.
Good evening and welcome to Dead Air Live. My name is Steve Sherblum. Tonight's program is titled Under My Thumb, and we're going to be looking at the many ways that men objectify women. By objectifying, we mean treating women as objects, as something to have rather than someone to be with, something to possess, rather than a whole person separate from men's needs. This discussion is rooted in a feminist critique of how women are oppressed in this culture, and tonight we want to look more deeply at men's part in it, what we as men do, why we do it, and what we get from it. I have three guests with me tonight, all of whom are men who have worked to change the way they and other men relate to women. My first guest is Jackson Katz, an author, lecturer, and man who works with a group called Real Men. Welcome, Jackson.
Hi.
My second guest is Brad Bennett, an anti-sexist activist and presently a counselor of emotionally disturbed children. Hi, Brad. Hello. And my third guest is Woody Kay, a professor of political science at Northeastern who works with a group called MESA, Men to End Sexual Assault. Welcome, Woody.
Thank you.
We'll be going to a tape shortly that explores more fully how women are treated as objects. To set some background, could we begin by describing how men are trained in this culture to see women as inferior and to treat them badly. Jackson, do you want to start?
Yes. I think from a very, 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 very early age, young boys are trained, as I'm sure I was, and I think I can speak for these guys as well. The worst thing that one of your male peers can say to you is that you look like a girl, you throw like a girl, you're a sissy, etc. So it starts at a very early age that young boys are trained to objectify women, objectify girls, or it's actually what they're being trained to do is to suppress the female side of their own personality. And I know that I've struggled with that from for a long time as I'm trying to become a more full person, to try to connect with the parts of me that I suppressed from a very early age growing up in the macho culture. And then if you combine that, you know, the peer kind of pressures on young boys with all the images of masculinity in the media, which is incredibly powerful in terms of socializing these young males. Look at the role models who are put forth to young boys as the epitome of masculinity. They tend to be, you know, macho athletes and actors who are acting tough and et cetera. And it has a lot of effect.
Mm-hmm. People who are strong, people who can't fail.
Right.
And I think in addition to that, again, from a very early age, that young boys and young men are taught to be successful, to strive, to achieve, to succeed, in the sense that they're sort of being taught to think mostly of themselves, that even those elements that are ostensibly doing for others, for example, when you're older, being, you know, married and providing for your family and things of that sort, those are prized more for what they say about you as a man. So I think that indeed, besides the things Jackson was mentioning, that men are brought up in our culture to be very self-centered.
And how does that affect the way that they end up treating the women that they're involved with?
Well, I think one of the things it allows men to do is not listen to women, not to pay attention to women. And so that if they wind up hurting women or putting them down, it's more that they are thinking about themselves, that it's a very selfish sort of attitude, mm-hmm. and it allows them to tune women out.
I have a story that actually illustrates this point. I counsel disturbed kids, and a couple weeks ago we dealt with the issue of sex in the boys' group, adolescent boys' group. Mm-hmm. And the boys in the group, they were all interested in finding out what was so big about pleasing the girl in sexual activity. Like, they couldn't even understand how that, you know, why that would be important, mm-hmm. or what the girl gets out of it. Mm-hmm. They knew what they got out of it, mm-hmm. but they didn't know, understand what the girl's point of view was.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that's typical of the culture at large? I mean, where do these boys get their ideas about sex?
They get them from all the institutions in our society, from TV, from their parents, from school, from peers. Mm-hmm. The message is everywhere that girls are inferior and they need to separate themselves from the girls in their lives.
And it feeds back into this success ethic, in the sense that for young men growing up, having a great deal of sexual activity, being with many girls is sort of the means to an end. It says a great deal about you as a male and you as an individual, that you must be really a wonderful male if you have many sexual experiences. It's the same sort of thing, the success ethic and this, mm-hmm. this sort of self-centeredness.
Regardless of what those sex experiences
are. Exactly, and regardless of what the woman herself, the girl herself, might think about it.
Mm-hmm. And let's face it, pornography just pervades the culture. And speaking about, you know, our generation, we grew up in a culture where pornographic images, both in the magazines, on TV, and advertising, and the movies, are just absolutely pervasive. So it's very difficult to look at a woman, a girl if you're a young kid, or a woman, as another human being when you're just constantly barraged with images of this two-dimensional sex object of your, you know, of your sexual release. Boys are very, very early on trained that girls are the object of their sexual attention and release. And it's very hard. It's very hard in trying to form, you know, intimate relationships with women as adults, as men, if we've grown up with this conditioning. For, like I said, I think it's just incredibly powerful. And I think that's directly linked to the level of violence, and I know that we're going to talk about that, the level of violence against women, because I think there's a direct connection between the objectification of women throughout the culture, specifically in the media, and I know we're going to talk about objectifying women in all different areas, but that objectification, and then combine that with the images of masculinity that you see in the media, that young boys are learning to be tough and rugged and to be macho and to be violent is to be male. And at the same time, women are victims and objects. It's a fatal mix between the two.
And boys are really taught to be individuals, and, you know, like you say, to be the rugged, you know, the Marlboro man.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And you can't be, you know, really related to somebody and connected with somebody if you're also being rugged and individual.
Right. Well, traditionally men think of weakness. They think connectedness and relationships and neediness and emotional neediness is weakness. So of course they're gonna recoil from that, because that's not what being a man is all about. You have to be vulnerable to be intimate. successfully intimate in a relationship with a woman, and men, you know, there's a tension there because men don't want to be vulnerable, because that's being less than masculine, because the way masculinity is constructed and defined in this culture, it doesn't allow for men to be vulnerable and weak or needy or emotional, quote unquote.
Mm-hmm. Or for that matter, to pay attention to what's happening around them. I remember it, again, I have a story. A few months ago, I was doing a speaking engagement at a local community college, and one of the men, and I hear this a lot from men, one of the college-age men said, well, don't you know that when I go out with someone, I try something, and she stops me, and I try a little while later, I try it again. She lets me get a little bit further this time, and you have to keep doing this, he tells me. That's the only way that men can have sex. And this whole idea that what sex means is aggressive pursuit on the part of the male, mm-hmm. that the woman may indeed resist, that's all part of it. She's supposed to do that, that sex is something that women have and men need to get away from them. It's something else that is delivered in the a message delivered in the culture that men grow up with, and this is their idea of what sexuality mm-hmm. is all about.
And it's impossible to see them as objects and
Absolutely.
Equals at the same time.
Exactly.
Okay, well now we're going to go to a tape that looks a little more in depth at objectification, both the history of it and how pervasive and the many different kinds. So let's go to that tape now.
Throughout recorded history, the culture has defined women as savior, women as sufferer, women as battleground, woman as devil, woman as the better half, the weaker sex, the dark side, the ball and chain, as home, as every damn thing except a plain and unique person. An object is a predictable and useful thing. It is what the observer defines it to be. The most extreme form of objectification is slavery, is the disregard of a human's own agenda for the purposes of fulfilling the owner's agenda and exacting power to make the slave comply. The issue of objectification involves not only how one individual sees another, but the differences in power between people. Although slavery has technically been abolished, recent legal cases requiring that married women have their husband's approval for name changes and abortions reveals that wives are still considered property of the husband. The Sharon Kowalski custody battle between Sharon's father and her longtime lover Karen Thompson shows that, until a woman is married, she belongs to her father. Men objectify women when they see women only as how they fit into particular men-defined categories. Because men have more power, these men-defined roles become the culturally accepted reality. Any particular part of a woman not fitting these roles becomes invisible, or a target of violence. Most of the discussion on the objectification of women has centered around the use of images of women in pornography and advertisements. Although the widespread use of photographs helps shape, solidify, choreograph men's expectations, and therefore defines the roles which men will impose on live women, it is not the whole picture. Women must also conform to men-defined roles of wives, girlfriends, mothers, working women, and subordinates, as well as follow general protocol defining behavior toward strangers. Failure to be a good mother, a friendly passerby, an understanding girlfriend, an accommodating secretary can have dire consequences. Even if a specific man does not carry through with the harassment or attack, the threats themselves are often enough to require women to adapt their behavior to the men's desired role. A woman's life is interrupted at work, at home, on the street, so often by men that she gets the impression that she's under constant scrutiny. Girls are hammered with advice, almost from birth, to choose roles which will offer the most protection in a world hostile to women. The dichotomy of good girl, bad girl, or Madonna whore arises in a limited and tricky choice around puberty. It is a balancing act a woman performs until death. A bad girl is a woman who is promiscuous, who is sexy rather than classy, a bimbo rather than educated, a whore rather than a lady. A whore belongs, sexually, to all or any man. Society sanctions violence against bad girls. And any woman who takes an unconventional route can slip into the whore class. Single women, divorced women, children of single mothers, lesbians, women alone in bars, cars, offices, women alone on the street, alone with several men, women working in male fields. Men may argue that this hostility is not that widespread. Women read the papers, hear the stories, and note the excuses for rape. These situations extend to grab possibly any woman who is not protected by a man. Therefore, it is a woman's relationship to a man that determines what the world makes of her and what it will allow the world to do to her. Her free will extends only so far as choosing whether to accept the protection of one man if offered or to fend off all men. In fact, her choice is not so free. Turning down an offer of protection, coming in the guise of attraction, love, material help, or guidance in school of work can be dangerous in itself. If interpreted as not considering a man's help as necessary or adequate, a woman can become fair game. A woman perceived as unprotected or protected by a not powerful enough man becomes the target of sexual harassment and violence. Many women opt for the protection of Madonna status. Women in this category are protected by a man as wives, girlfriends, or as virgins still owned by their fathers. This role is not without its heavy costs. Even in the best of circumstances, it requires compulsory heterosexuality. It requires a domestic life. It requires childbirth and the bulk of work and worry of raising a family. A woman still cannot express her individuality and uniqueness. Although married women, good wives, and mothers are considered safe from the impersonal violence of the street and workplaces, they have bartered their autonomy for protection. However, just as society sanctions violence against women who do not conform to Madonna roles, society sanctions the use of coercion and violence against those who do not, cannot live up to the enormous demands men place on their women. Men expect good girls to be nurturing and understanding, a resource without pressing needs or aspirations of their own. While men avoid intimate relationships with most everyone, they rely heavily on their women as emotional outlet. All their fears, hope, anger, and sadness become channeled toward the designated woman. Her individuality is not recognized. Her time is not her own. This designation is romanticized as love. A man's love has the highest precedence in this culture, far above the needs and desires of any woman. It is inescapable and exacting. Men who have shot or stabbed their wives and watched them die have been said to have loved them too much. It could be argued that women who choose the protection of marriage have merely consolidated the source of violence. Every 18 seconds, a woman is beaten by her partner. Every 10 minutes, a woman is murdered. Women are beaten and killed because they did not live up to a man's expectations. They are beaten for failing to understand and fix his problems, failing to be faithful, failing to be uncomplaining when he has multiple partners, failing to control her fertility, failing to submit to sex on demand, failing to stay with him until death, failing to cook exactly what he wants. Even if a woman manages to avoid violence, it has been at tremendous cost. Women in a women-hating world have learned to settle for less, learned to stay indoors, learned to stay out of men's way, learned to adapt to moving through the world on other people's schedules. One has to think how many Marie Curies, how many Amelia Earharts, Georgia O'Keeffe's, Eudora Welty's, how many Sojourner Truths have been silenced.
Welcome back to the studio. At the beginning of the show, we saw some on-the-street interviews, and we didn't see all of them, but the feeling I got from when we did the interviews was that most people thought that things had gotten a little better. I mean, the tape we just watched was pretty bleak. Do you think that things have gotten better, particularly in terms of men's violence against women, rape, sexual harassment, battering?
Well, Steve, at the beginning of the tape of the show, when people say things like things are getting better, what they're in fact referring to is that for a very narrow segment of society, particularly predominantly white middle class women, there are more opportunities and you see more of them in jobs that you didn't see them in before. But the basic problem of objectification is still there, and the violence and the harassment that results from that is still a problem. We do know, for example, that according to the FBI, that 1 out of 3 women will be raped sometime in her life. We know that 3 to 4 million women each year are battered in their homes. We know that 85% of women working in the workforce are harassed while they're at work. So in terms of the violence against women and the abuse that women have to put up with, that's the best guess would be that that is at the very least staying the same, probably getting worse, as women move out more into the workplace and are therefore more liable for harassment and abuse and things of that sort.
Mm-hmm. Do you think they're moving out of traditional roles and moving out of some kind of protection?
Well, as the tape we just saw suggests, that one of the predominant ways in which patriarchal society keeps women in their places to keep them in those protected roles. And indeed, as they move out of those, there is a, sort of this sense that women are becoming more vulnerable. Indeed, in the workplace, as we know, there is a great deal of harassment. A labor attorney was telling me recently that the number of court cases that are being filed regarding harassment in the workplace has gone up dramatically in the last couple of years. Now, whether that's an indication that harassment itself is getting worse, or that now there's simply more opportunities for redress of it or more reporting of it, that's not exactly clear. But it's true that as more women work, as long as objectification continues, there will be more harassment in the workplace.
I think we also have to be clear that violence by men against women is used as a form of social control of women, and that as women are increasing, in certain classes of women are increasing their economic power and their social mobility and educational level, there has been a corresponding, I think it's a difficult to prove actual numbers, but there has been, it seems that there has been an increase in violence. There's certainly been anecdotal evidence across the country, and people like myself and Brad who work with young boys in the real serious sexual violence by, you know, young males. I think there's a direct link between women, you know, achieving certain things in educational and career areas and the corresponding rise in violence against women, because it's men who are threatened, you know, collectively men are threatened by this increasing power of women, and the one recourse that men have, no matter how successful women can be educationally or economically, the one power that men still have over women is the physical power to dominate them. I think that we have to be clear that there has been a male backlash against the gains that women have made over the past 25, 30 years.
I think another way to look at the question of how have things changed is to look at whether men have changed, whether men have started to give up violence and control as a way to relate to women. And I think working with batterers, counseling batterers, I know that a very small minority of men who do get abusive in their relationships with women seek help. And then an even smaller minority of that actually stick with it longer than one session. And then an even smaller minority than that actually change. And the only way you can tell is by asking the women in their lives whether they feel safer. And so there's a small minority of men who are actually working on changing. And I think the only way we can really find out whether things are getting better is by asking women if they feel safer. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I think that's really an important point, because as Jackson was suggesting earlier, one of the most insidious things about all of this is that it is a form of social control over women. And one of the things that we seldom talk about is that to be a woman in this society is to be at greater risk. They are at greater risk from harassment, at violence from people they know. They're not safe in homes. They're not safe on the streets. And indeed, particularly these days in this city, everyone needs to be concerned about personal safety. But there is this assumption, which is largely borne out by the evidence, that women need to be more concerned than that. And the fact that half of society is at greater risk than the other half, for no other reason than the fact they happen to be female, is a cause of great concern. And that problem remains.
I was struck in reading, you know, statistics about violence against women, particularly rape statistics, that about 70% of rape take place between the woman and someone she knows. Mm-hmm. And obviously battering takes place between she and a man that she knows. Mm-hmm. And harassment at work takes place between a woman and a man that she knows. Mm-hmm. I mean, it seems, you know, in my growing up, there was so much the stereotype that you had to be afraid of strangers in dark alleys, you had to be afraid of people you didn't know. Mm-hmm. And it seems like so much more that you have to be afraid of people you do know, mm-hmm. that they're exactly. The ones who are actually going to hurt you.
Exactly. And that's particularly true for women. As I've said to some other groups, if I go out with some male friends, I don't have much fear, for example, if they're going to suddenly rob me or beat me up or something of that sort. But women tell me quite frequently that when they go out on first dates, when they're just going with people, with friends, going to parties, situations where people ostensibly are supposed to relax and have a good time, there is still that element of risk, and that women say that they, you know, and they're being told now at Northeastern University where I teach, there are these seminars and publications that say when you go to a party, be careful, be thinking, be aware, be this, be that. The notion is that women aren't supposed to relax anywhere. And so not just looking in terms of the actual numbers of actual incidents, if you look at the threat overall and the control that places on women's lives, that, as I said, remains unchanged and is still a tremendous problem.
And Steve, getting to the point that you made about the fact that so many rapes occur between people who know each other, so many men who know the women that they've raped, etc. One of the things I think that's so difficult in talking to men or talking with men or men talking about rape is that rape isn't something that takes place by some stranger in a dark alley, but it's rather on a continuum of normal heterosexual relations. The way men relate to women, rape is on that continuum. So a lot of guys, when they hear about rape, when they talk about rape, they get defensive because they see their own behavior. Maybe, I'm not saying that men, mm-hmm. these men are rapists, but they see how their own behavior could go one step further and then it would be rape. So in other words, rape is hits close to home for a lot of guys. Is what I'm trying to say. Mm-hmm. It's very much connected to the normal way that men and women are trained to relate to each other. Female submission and male dominance are the twin pillars of, you know, patriarchal control by men over women. Men are trained to be dominant, and rape is just an extension of that dominance.
Mm-hmm. And the whole notion of rape being predominantly something that comes from somebody jumping out of bushes or whatever is one way in which men can distance themselves from sort of their own behavior. As long as rape is considered this crime of violence and force, and we don't talk about things like economic manipulation, you know, I paid for this date, things of that sort, or psychological manipulation. If you really loved me, you would. We're going to get this far, and you're going to stop now. All these things that men use are again part of the same continuum. They're not necessarily using physical force in the sense of restraint or something of that sort, but that is also part of what goes into the rape culture. And again, this notion of the use of myths, of strangers, of psychopaths, of you know, deranged people, is one way in which men are able to sort of distance themselves from their own behavior.
Do you think that men get so used to having that kind of control over women and getting what they want that they don't even, I mean, it seems like men don't even recognize coercion as rape?
Oh, I think that's absolutely true. In fact, I think that men generally, I think, are very unreflective about their own behavior and their own sexuality. There is, one of the things I hear a lot is this idea that once men reach a certain point of sexual excitement, they're no longer responsible for their own behavior. I think it's back to what I was speaking about before, sort of the self-centered notion that they are so excited that whatever they want after that is actually a matter of physical compulsion. And that's sort of the way they tend to think about these things.
Like raging hormones. Mm-hmm. You know, boys will be boys. All these cultural cliches and myths that support any kind of vile, violent activity by men, because that's just the way it is. Mm-hmm. You know?
If I could, I'd like to go back to what you brought up, Jackson, about the continuum, because I think that's a real important point that often tonight, in fact, we've even talked about men on the general level, but I feel like we're all on that continuum, that we've all been trained, you know, to use various forms of control and objectification and entitlement to get what we want, to manipulate, and that we're all on that continuum somewhere. And on one end is rape and battering and stuff like that, but we're all on there somewhere, and that we're all capable of that because that's what we've been taught.
Right.
That's important to remember.
And it's easy to put rape, you know, and violence at one end and say, well, I'm not violent. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe I'm manipulative. Maybe, you know, I keep pushing until I get what I want, but it's not violent.
Mm-hmm. I think what you're just bringing up is touching on why so many men are so defensive when they talk about sexual violence, when they're confronted with feminist ideas or feminists, is that they do recognize at some level, whether it's extremely conscious or not, they recognize that at some level their own behavior is sexist and it's you know, dominating and it's unacceptable. And so therefore they stereotype the people who are bringing up the issue, like for instance feminists, as, you know, angry, unattractive man-haters. Because they're being defensive, because it's getting to the core of who they are. Because every man knows they have to look themselves in the mirror. They know, you know, that they objectify women. They know that they've abused women. You know, lots of men have abused women and have coerced women into sex and have had sex with women who are drunk, et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. So, and also they know if one in three women are the victim of rape or sexual assault, that means that an awful lot of men are guilty of raping an awful lot of women and children and girls, and therefore, all of us, even those of us who haven't, you know, done those terrible things, have brothers, have friends, who have fathers, have cousins, have colleagues, and who wants to look at your brother and say, this is a rapist? You know, it's like, it really does cut very close to home, and you know, one out of three is such an incredibly high statistic that it means that, you know, every man is affected.
And this works on so many levels. The again, not just the actual perpetrators, but if you look on downtown streets, the men who make comments to women as they go by, whistling and staring and shouting and horn honking and all these kinds of things, which are on this same sort of a continuum. It is, again, part of that objectification, that as long as you regard a woman as an object, not as an equal human being, well, it's certainly all right to do that. In fact, that's supposed to be a form of appreciation. The woman is supposed to be complimented via those kinds of things. But again, that being pervasive throughout the culture is one of the things that's a product of that objectification, and it reinforces it. And so even individuals who may not further act upon that by, say, actually carrying out an assault are still contributing to an atmosphere that makes that sort of assault permissible. And that goes even one step further. Something that Jackson was saying I think is really important is that as men, even those of us who are trying to change or grappling with these issues, we still see all the time, every day, instances of where men are abusing women in some form or another, either verbally or physically. We see it, you know, on the subways, on the streets. We see it at work. We see it at home. And there is it's very difficult for men to confront other men who do these things. And that in some sense, those of us who see these things happening and don't do anything about it, again, we are becoming part of the problem because we're acquiescing to that abusive behavior by our inaction.
I think that men often need help mm-hmm. in naming that objectification. Mm-hmm. In counseling batterers, we use a list of controlling behaviors. And when we ask men if they've ever abused their partner, and they say no. But then we ask them, have you ever done this? Have you ever called her a name? Mm-hmm. Have you ever called her up to find out where she is? Have you ever followed her in the car, et cetera, mm-hmm. et cetera, down the line, and they check some of them off. Mm-hmm. So I think that often they don't know, we don't know mm-hmm. what is objectifying. Mm-hmm. And we need to help each other with it, and we need to ask women for feedback,
Mm-hmm. We talk about, all of these women, almost all women being oppressed by these things, or all women being. I mean, who are the men? It's clearly not a few psychopaths. Mm-hmm. It's obviously normal men.
Quote, unquote.
Mm-hmm. Well, statistically, the majority, mm-hmm. And that they're not considered abnormal for mm-hmm. it. I mean, that this is, given our culture, this mm-hmm. is normal. Mm-hmm. I mean, what does that say about our culture? Mm-hmm.
Well, as I said before, there is, for example, this notion that what sexuality is pursuit and capture. That's normal sex. The idea of teenagers, groping in the back seat of a car, that's supposed to be very cute, that sort of thing, that the woman has to fight off these young boys with raging hormones. The notion of getting a woman drunk so that you can have sex with her is something that's treated in television and movies as being normal and funny. It's the stuff of comedy. It's called seduction, things of that sort. I mean, you're right, that is those behaviors that really are very coercive are considered part of mainstream sort of quote-unquote, as I use the quotes, normal culture. But it is a culture that's defined by males and these sort of masculine values that we were talking about earlier. It's not normal to the extent that that's a culture that women have agreed to or participated in creating.
What do men get out of it? What do we get out of it? We are men who live in this culture. We have the privilege of this violence. We have the privilege of being on the upside. What do we get out of it? What is that privilege?
I think on the surface, we get a lot of services by objectifying. We get sexual services, we get emotional services, we get housework. A lot of very concrete things that we get by objectifying and controlling women in our lives. I think there's another kind of deeper level also that has to do with our inner psyche and what we believe to be is our manhood. And I think that often men objectify or try to control women because they themselves feel threatened or scared in some way. Mm-hmm. They feel that their manhood, as they define it, is threatened. So they lash out, or they try to control, or they objectify by not treating the woman as a fully human person. Mm-hmm. So I think in some sense it is a response to that inner vulnerability that they feel or threatening feeling.
I think that's really.
Go ahead.
I think it's really important. The last point in particular, that it's not also. It's just not what men get out of it. What men get to avoid, in the sense that everyone has insecurities. Everyone has feelings of inadequacy from time to time. There are available to men through male privilege means to deal with those. I felt like that if men did not rely upon coercive mechanisms, did not rely upon sort of manipulative means, then men would have to sink or swim exclusively on their attractiveness as people. And that a lot of men have trouble with that. That's very frightening. And being able to avoid that through objectification is, in a sense, another one of the things that men get out of objectification.
Mm-hmm. When I did the on-the-street interviews, the other thing that I came away feeling was I actually talked to a lot more men than you saw in that clip, and that was because most of the men denied that there was a problem. Mm-hmm. You know, many of them didn't want to talk about it, or if they did talk about it, they said, well, the older generation was bad, you know, but mm-hmm. things have changed, and women can go anywhere and do anything. And I would ask them, do you have a privilege as being a man? And many of them denied it, mm-hmm. which was a little shocking to me. And I was wondering how men could not see the privileges. And I was wondering if you could talk about what some of those privileges are.
Well, part of the privilege is not seeing that you have a privilege. You just completely take for granted, for instance, walking out at night, going jogging at, you know, 12 o'clock at night. You know, you just go out and you do it. I mean, in certain parts of certain cities, you can't do it, but largely across the country, you can do it. Or men, you know, getting drunk and not worrying about getting a ride home from, a frat party or a, you know, campus party or something like that. You don't think about it. You just, you know, men don't think about it. It's actually incredible to me. I mean, it's been a few years ago that struck me when I was walking home one night, you know, that I couldn't be walking home across the campus. There had been a couple of rapes where I was at school. And I didn't even think about the fact that I was at risk because, frankly, I really wasn't at risk. And it really struck me one night when I was waiting for a female dorm mate of mine who was very late coming home, and I wasn't even that worried. And then her roommate was really, really worried because it was getting late, and I was thinking, wow, oh my God, you know, I wouldn't be worried if a male friend of mine was late because I just figured that he was, you know, at some party or something. Mm-hmm. So that's part of male privilege is that you don't think about the fact that you do have a privilege. Mm-hmm.
You're safe enough that you don't have to worry about that so much.
Right.
Another privilege, I think, is that of we expect women and other people to take care of us as people. And we sometimes, to the point where we don't take care of ourselves, you know, we expect it so much mm-hmm. from especially the women in our lives mm-hmm. that we don't know how to do it anymore because we don't expect to do it. Mm-hmm. So I think that's a large privilege.
And another one I thought about is that one of the things that when you read about men who commit sexual violence or abuse, one of the things you sort of see is that how angry they are, and that it seems to be they're acting upon some sort of anger, feelings of inadequacy, things of this sort. And as I mentioned earlier, these are feelings that everyone has at some point or another. There is available to men, through male privilege, ways that are quite legitimate within the context of the male-defined culture to work those out, that sort of acting violent towards women, towards children, is one way that men have of trying to deal with some of their own personal hang-ups, their own personal problems. And that is a direct result of the privilege they have, or see that they have, to engage in that kind of abusive behavior.
Mm-hmm. Along those lines, Woody, one of the things that I've done over the years is worked in a detention center for adolescent males. It's a very progressively run place. It's not like a prison camp, but we deal with some really tough kids. And typically, I'm a counselor, so typically we would be talking to some kid behind closed doors, and the kid would break down and start crying, you know, about the fact that he feels, you know, totally low self-esteem. He doesn't feel loved. He's scared. He doesn't know what he's doing with his life or anything. I mean, these are adolescent males with incredible different kinds of pressures on them and family violence, et cetera. Mm-hmm. So they really are vulnerable kids at one level. Even though we read about them in the paper and we think, what a little, you know, horror show this kid is. Behind closed doors, this is a real person who has serious, you know, serious emotional problems. But of course, once they go back out into their peer group, that, you know, behind, you know, they come up from behind the closed door, of course, then it's all of a sudden they're Mr. Macho again. It's an act to mask a deeper insecurity. There's no question about it. And I know from personal experience, as growing up as a football player and a jock, that some of the toughest kids, and I was one of them, are deeply insecure underneath. And it's mm-hmm. and like I say, when I speak with groups of kids and college students, it's a hell of a lot easier to be a macho man than it is to be vulnerable. It's a hell of a lot easier to go on a football field and beat heads than it is to speak up when some guy tells a joke about rape at a party or makes a sexist comment. It's a lot easier because you get a lot more support for being a tough guy, mm-hmm. than it is if you question the whole system because it's, you know, this is basic Freudian insight that some of the most homophobic and violent men are the ones who are the most themselves afraid of their own vulnerability, their own femaleness, their own homosexuality.
Mm-hmm. Well, getting on that point about homosexuality, I mean, how do you think that this hatred of women, which, I mean, we're clearly a woman-hating society, and mm-hmm. we, you know, as men are taught to do that, how do you think that ties in with hatred of gays? Mm-hmm.
It's an amazing thing when you look at male homophobia that there is something, again, in this male culture we've been talking about that is terribly, terribly threatened by homosexuality and by homosexual men. And what is so curious about that is if you look at the actual facts and evidence, who has reason to be afraid of whom? And there, the level of violence against gays by straight men is staggering. Yet it is the part of the myth that straight men have something to fear, something to be afraid of, a direct threat from gay men. I mean, it's an incredible sort of inversion of the myth.
I think it's because they're projecting their fear of themselves. The fear that's within them is then projected onto another person, mm-hmm. which is a gay male, mm-hmm. and that's where it comes from. The gay male isn't really a threat in and of himself. It's what he brings up in the inner core of the psyche of the individual male, mm-hmm. I think
that's a large part of it, and kind of another large part of it is kind of the dogma of what it means to be a heterosexual man in our society, and that anything else that is not part of that dogma is considered different and very scary. So that includes women, mm-hmm. that includes gay men, that includes people of other colors, other classes. Mm-hmm. You know, everything that is different is kind of pushed out and is kind of threatening.
Right. Mm-hmm. I think the critical piece in what you just said is that gay males in the heterosexist culture are feminized. If you look at the terms, you're a femme, that means you're gay. But it means also you're a woman, and so it's what one of the things that gay males bring up for straight men is that there's a female side to the male personality that has to be suppressed to maintain, you know, your masculine, you know, visage, you know, your masculine image, and so gay males really, really threaten that concept because mm-hmm. gay males have, you know, sexual relations with males, which is what a female is supposed to do. So I mean, look at all the metaphors and all the cliches about what a gay is, a limp-wristed female, you know, it's all another way of saying you're not a real man, you're a woman.
I wonder too if men's fear, you know, it is fear, it isn't just hatred. There's a mm-hmm. lot of fear in homophobia. Mm-hmm. I wonder sure. if that isn't also that they know that they treat women like mm-hmm. shit. Mm-hmm. So if this is someone who's interested in them, mm-hmm. they're going to treat them like shit because that's the equation. I mean, it's always a one up, one down.
I think that's exactly right, because what happens in these sorts of encounters that we're describing here is that it sort of messes up the power relationship. The way the culture is set up now is that men have power over women, and that expresses itself sexually. And now if you have a man who has sex with other men, this is now somehow, this turns the tables. For straight men, that there is now someone who is exercising power, and it could be directed at them, and that's very disconcerting for men. It's almost in the same sense that yeah, as you were suggesting that this is what they do to women, the straight men, and here is a gay man who might do the same thing to them.
We're starting to run out of time, but I wanted to quickly touch another stereotype, which is that men who batter are, you know, typically lower class, uneducated, drunk, and that's not, you know, that violence against women is not really, goes across class. It's really a lower class problem, and it's that the men are taking out, you know, that they are oppressed, and so they're taking out on, quote, their women. I mean, is that, what do you think about that stereotype? Is that hold true?
Mm-hmm. Well, in counseling batterers, I've counseled men from all kinds of classes, races, cultural backgrounds. It cuts through all of those boundaries. And it's different. I mean, it's different for different men. Every man that uses objectification or violence has his or her own, his own style. And I think often objectification that happens by middle or upper class men is very private. It's much more private than men of the working class. And they can shield themselves a lot better because mm-hmm. they have the resources and the power to do that. Mm-hmm. So I think it's equally as prevalent, it's just behind closed doors.
And the fact that there is this myth that it's primarily something that happens among lower classes is again one way in which upper middle class and upper class men can escape from their own responsibilities. And the fact that if we're talking about people who are prominent men, men with position and status, and people tend not to believe this about them, it's interesting how all of these sorts of means of oppression, classism and racism and ableism and homophobia all sort of reinforce each other when it comes to these questions of violence against mm-hmm. women.
I'd like to switch the topic a little bit and talk about possible solutions. I know that you've all worked, you know, with anti-sexist groups, and I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about what the works your, you know, what your groups are and what you do.
Mm-hmm. Well, I guess I'll give the ceasefire pitch. My group, Real Men, and Woody's group, Men 10 Sexual Assault, as well as Emerge, is a coalition. We're trying to build an anti-sexist men's movement in Boston. And as a coalition effort, this week we have a thing called, we're calling it Ceasefire Action Week. And it's a whole week of activities designed to call that attention to the fact that men need to take responsibility for violence against women. And the centerpiece of this week's activities is this media wall that we constructed. It's 35 feet long and 6 feet high, and it has 450 articles from the Boston area print media since January 1990 detailing violence against women. And we're going to display it all around the city and all around the state. The purpose of it is to say to men specifically that you can't ignore this. This is a huge problem. It's a crisis. The level of violence in this culture is against women is at crisis levels, and men can't just, you know, happily go along our way and not take responsibility for it. Because women know that they live with violence, you know, every day. But men are the ones, as we were discussing, who aren't paying such close attention. And so, like my group's activities, you know, Real Men, are designed to, in whatever way we can, with the meager resources at our disposal, to make men start thinking about these things and talking about these issues. And I speak as well, college kids and high school kids, and especially to you know, men like who are in positions of leadership and authority. Coaches, teachers, fathers need to, you know, say firmly to the young boys who are looking to them for leadership. They need to say in no uncertain terms that violence against women is unacceptable in any of its forms, whether it be verbal, emotional, psychological, or physical. And again, as we've worked with young boys, no, these boys are looking for direction. They're looking for leadership. They're looking for some, you know, strength in some of the men who are role models in their lives. And it's clear that a lot of men have failed in terms of providing that kind of leadership and role modeling for the young boys.
In addition, if you can look at it on a peer level for a moment, one of the other things we're hoping to come out of this Ceasefire Week is that we can, as men, talk among ourselves and persuade other men not just to look at their own behavior, but to make comments and to declare to other people that their behavior is unacceptable, not just in their capacity as role models, but also as peers. One of the things that we know is that violence against women is an element in male bonding, that men sort of bond together to abuse women. And one of our hopes is that, in fact, we have a workshop for that, if I can plug that for a second, that is scheduled for Thursday, October 18th at 7:30 in the Hastings Room at the First Church Congregational in Cambridge. It's at 11 Garden Street. And we're going to be talking about the issues that face men when they do try to confront one another about all of our sexism. And again, the idea is to try and get men to go forward from this week and to be making those kinds of comments when they see that sort of abusive behavior. And one last thing I do want to plug very quickly, if I can, is that as the Ceasefire Week will be, one of the major events is a poetry reading that is scheduled for Saturday, October 20th at 8. That's also at the First Church in Cambridge Congregational at 11 Garden Street. And this is a reading, a poetry reading to raise money for the Boston Area Rape Crisis Center. So it's a benefit. We have three poets, and we hope people will come. Yeah.
And one other thing about that's we're doing in correlation with Ceasefire Action Week, the word action is a key word there. Is that men need to get out and do these things publicly, you know, take action, whether, but either in the private life or publicly. One of the things that we're going to be doing is Andrew Dice Clay, the deeply misogynist comedian, who is the comedic equivalent of violent pornography, is going to be in Worcester next Wednesday night at the Worcester Centrum, and we're going to be there protesting and handing out leaflets, because our feeling is, you know, with the level of violence against women and children and you know, immigrants and people of color that we have in our society in Massachusetts, to bring a guy like that in who makes jokes about it, who objectifies women completely and makes jokes about rape as a way, that's the way he makes his living, that's just not acceptable. And so we're going to be out there, and we feel like men should support that kind of thing.
I think it's important to do that political and public confrontation. And I think it's also important to talk to people that are in our lives, not only to work on our own issues, but to talk to family and friends. And I also think it's important to work with kids. You know, that you and I have done that, and I'm sure all of us have talked to and been with kids in our lives. And I think that's when they start learning about all this stuff. So I think education, curriculum, counseling for kids, all this kinds of stuff, that's a real important part of this whole puzzle.
Mm-hmm. And particularly, when we're talking about getting people to alter their behavior, it's particularly important to get men to listen to women. And that's the most important thing, that men need to wake up and pay attention. And whether we do this through political action or through education or through individual counseling or whatever, the key is that they need to hear and understand what's happening for women.
It's not like feminism hasn't put out a great deal of literature on this issue.
That's true.
Well, we have a question from our studio audience. Go ahead.
I just would like to ask either of you, any one of you, how do you either counsel or personally, how do you stop objectifying women? How do you, specifically, how would you counsel somebody to stop what they're doing? How should they realize what they're doing?
I think that's a good question. and speaking as a counselor, I think one of the things, well, a couple of techniques that I've used. One is that I don't try to come down too hard on men or boys that I'm counseling. That if I come down too hard right away, they put up walls. I mean, we're all taught to do that. So that's one thing that I remember in the beginning. Another is that I think as men, we're not taught to be very empathic. So a lot of what I do is empathy work, you know, really talking to the man or the child, asking them how it would feel to be in the woman or the girl's position or any other person. See if they can feel that, because that's where it starts. That's where if we can feel the pain, then we can start to change, I think.
Can I have a follow-up?
Sure.
Would it also be a good idea to project female role models to these young men?
I agree totally. I think that's very important.
I haven't heard that yet.
I think that's very important. I think one of I think it's important for men to see not only powerful women and female role models, it's also important for men to see other men supporting female role models. I agree with that totally, and I think that it's extremely important then for men not only to be sort of in leading their own movement to get men to change, but to be involved in the women's movement in supportive roles. I think that's extremely important.
Thank you. So what do you feel, I mean, in the men that you come in contact with in your groups, what do you see you have to work on in your own life? I mean, on a personal level. So what is, you know, what's your own story?
Everything. I mean, just because, like, for instance, my orientation is political activism, but I understand that's not enough, because we have to be working, you know, I have to be working on my own stuff at the same time as working on, you know, public political stuff, because in some ways, like I said earlier, it's easier to be public and political than it is to really work on the conditioned stuff that goes very deeply to the core of your personality. So it's a constant struggle. I mean, there's no question about it. And I don't think I can. I think I can speak for all of us when I say that we're not putting forth ourselves here as these, you know, great men who have just completely worked out all the sexism in our personality, because that's just not true. And no one should think that we are saying that. Mm-hmm. It's a constant struggle. It's like you try to work on your own stuff, you try to work on political action at the same time, and try to change other men, and you're constantly reassessing your own self and feeling like a hypocrite sometimes. Because, you know, again, we were socialized and conditioned in this sexist culture. So I think men should be clear about that guys who are involved in this movement, the anti-sexist men's movement, don't feel, you know, aren't saying that we've got it all together, and you guys out there don't. It's like we do too, all of us do, but we need to engage the discussion. We need to be engaged in it. It's a process. It's a very long and difficult process. Mm-hmm. And we're going to feel stupid and awkward, and we do feel hypocritical and all these other kind of mixed emotions. But it's our responsibility to go through that.
My perspective on all this is as an educator, since I do teach at university. And when you teach, you're also learning at the same time. Since I've been involved in this, I have learned so much. Part of it comes from understanding the world of women. Part of it also is coming to understand a lot about myself. And one of the things that to sort of echo what Jackson is saying is that you never do stop learning. There are always things to find out about yourself, about social problems, about things of that sort. And to talk to other men and to listen to how they approach these things is also to learn a great deal about ourselves.
I think for me, one of the most important messages of the women's movement in the late 60s, early 70s, and continuing, is that the personal is political. Mm-hmm. And so I think that we have had the privilege not to see, you know, not to see the oppression, not to see the objectification. So one of the things that I try to work on is being sensitive to oppression, to my objectification of women, to being in conversations with women and dominating them. So I try to be sensitive to that. In working on, in relationship with my partner, being sensitive to the fact that she has every right not to trust men because of past experiences, and that, you know, that's not personal about me, but part of it is, mm-hmm. and that I need to work on that part that is personal. And to be sensitive to the fact that women have every right not to trust men. And it makes our job harder to develop a trusting relationship. It makes it hard for both of us.
I concur with a lot of what you're saying, that in, you know, what growth that I feel like I have done has come out of some out of self-reflection, some out of reading feminist literature, but probably mostly out of talking to women in my life and learning to listen. I mean, I think that it's difficult for men to listen, and that they don't even recognize how little they listen to women. And I feel like that's something that has made an enormous difference in my life and will continue to do so. Well, thank you for coming. I want to, we have to wrap up the show now. I hope that this has been as educational for you as it has been for me.
Absolutely.
That's our show for tonight. Thank you and good night.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. Oh yeah, oh yeah. You know, life is all about expression. You only live once and you're not coming back. So express yourself, yeah.
Express yourself. You gotta be you and only you, babe. Express yourself and let me be me. Express yourself. Don't tell me what I cannot do, baby. Come on and work your body.
Now, you wanna be like Bob. Bob got it going on with no job. And everything Rob got, he got from
Robin.
And everything she got from
Robin.
My girl, I wanna be like
Jackie.
Got both chains and I think that's whack. Tom and Dick wanna be like Harry. Little do they know he's biting off Barry. Stan was a scam, but then he's legit. Mercedes coupe, home true with no kid. A businessman with a people for a reason. Not like Tim because it's in this season.
Yeah.
all-girl band, and I'm with the gig.